you know, we all know when we open our utility bills, all that stuff that falls out. Well, you could be one of those things that falls out. Okay? Again, it's kind of like that social media thing with a little higher cost. How many will really commit? How many will really do something about it? But it's something to think about, okay? If it's a utility bill with a little line on the bottom of it, I've used that before. I used to work for municipalities. We were pretty good at that. A lot of people actually read that little line at the bottom. Now, it's very key, if you've done that, to make sure that your billing folks, whose number is also on that bill, know about what it is you're messaging. Because they're the ones that they're not going to call you. They're going to call the billing people. What's this thing on the bottom? Maybe you're having a household hazardous waste collection. Okay, so you want to make sure the billing people know this. Because they really don't want to be transferring the calls to you. They really want to be in the loop. You just get them upset if they don't know. Your newsletter. Of course, the days of printed newsletters seem to be going away. I still love a printed newsletter. The Illinois Recycling Association, we do an electronic newsletter. Where I work, in Will County, I have an electronic newsletter. You have to sign up to receive my newsletter in the county. I have over 1,500 people who've signed up. They want to read my newsletter. I average 350 opens a month. 350 people know what's going on. And all the rest, we're too busy. So, and we all know that. We all get lots of emails and we just don't follow them all the time. So, signs. When we have a one-day collection event at the county, guaranteed 10% of the people who come to that event will tell us that the only reason they knew we were having the event is they happened to be up early driving around and they passed a sign for the event. Awesome. I'm so glad I spent $2,000 promoting this. All I knew was that sign. But it's very important. The signs are important. It was a big controversy a few years ago. We had a brand new logo for our programs at Will County as part of the stimulus package, willcountygreen.com. Should we put it on the cars or should we put it on the cars? Huge debate, okay? Lots of waste. Cars are going down the road for 2 miles. Now we're just going to read willcountygreen.com. Who's going to see that? You know, there's a heck of a lot of businesses that actually put that stuff. Occasionally people stop at stop sign, red lights, maybe they're parked in a parking lot somewhere. Who knows? Maybe they'll read it and they'll use it. Put it in that iPhone. Check us out. So we did. We put it all out there. We got a good response from that. People know they can find information on our website. Just to give you an indication, we opened the website in November of 2010. And that website went from having very few hits, a couple thousand, to 37,000 people have seen it as of the last time I ran, which is probably the beginning of this year. So awesome, absolutely awesome. We're seeing more and more people. So we don't really have a good goal for that, just to have to join the website here. How do you set your goal for how many people should view your website? And at the county, I know that we have almost 700,000 residents. Great, some of them are really little, they're not allowed to be on the internet. But still, are all of them even on the internet? How many are on the internet? And if they are on the internet, do they really have an interest in typing in Will County Green? Because I gotta tell you, I have two kids in school, and I don't have an interest in typing in their school website every day of my life to find out what's going on at the school. And I care about what's going on at the school. I have a vested interest in going, but I have other things to do. So there's give and take, but you don't know how to, if I could give you some great way to figure out a goal for what you want for your website is, I would tell you. I have yet to find it. So I'm open to suggestions. We talked about a little social media. Another one is blogs. We have a thing in our area, I don't know, this is supposed to be nationwide, so many of you might have seen these. AOL decided to launch a local newspaper called Patch. And the Patch is dedicated to trying to get local voices talking about local events and then getting advertising from local advertisers so that those companies are seen by the residents of that area. So it's a good business concept from what I can tell. They came to us and they asked us, would you like to do a blog for us? Prior to this, I had never been in the blog sphere. Sure, somebody asked, we'll do that, sure. So once a week, I try and write a blog about a different environmental aspect. It's a different way to approach things. You can do it on a very personal level, You can do it on a business level. There's a lot of different ways you can blog. But it's something you should consider because, again, you can open up your own blog. It's harder to get a following that way. But you can really do a lot, and it's free. It's your time. It's somebody on your staff's time. Okay? So it's just something to think about. Press releases, tried and true. Now, of course, we have less newsprint. And with less newsprint, we have less editors, we have less reporters. One of the things that's happened because of that is when you do a press release, a lot of times they actually will just run with it. It's not like they're going to really spend a lot of time changing it up. They'll shorten it. So make sure you always follow the pyramid rule. Okay? You want the most important stuff at the top, okay? And then the least important stuff at the bottom. Because if they do decide to log it off, you at least got the main points across. Definitely that's a great way to go. You should always do as many press releases as you can. Because at the very least, the newspaper knows, you know, if I need a news story, I need some fill-in, they got to call this person, they're always sending stuff. They probably have got something they've got in front of them. And develop relationships with them, too. That's always a good thing, too. Just to know who they are, who are the editors, who's the reporter that covers your area. Have some kind of communication, open communication with them is a good thing. Your greeting, something a lot of people take for granted. You know, you answer, you get the person's voicemail, and all you ever hear on the end of the voicemail, if they're not here, please leave a message kind of thing. I mean, you can be friendly, sure. But why not take that opportunity to say, we're having an event this week, or, you know, our next upcoming event is this day, or, you know, please remember to recycle your paper, whatever it is you want to say, okay? Don't forget that it's really important you conserve water. I don't know, whatever it is, you know, it's Water Conservation Month, okay? It's Bike to Work Week. Whatever it is you want to get out there, here's an opportunity. All those people who are giving you voice messages, they had to listen to that before they could leave you the voice message. So, pamphlets, brochures, we do lots of these. This is an old one that I have that I threw up here. We've actually redesigned this one since then. But they're really nice. You can get them in libraries. They'll put them out for you for free. If you're a government agency, I can't speak for businesses on that one. But certainly a business can put them out at their own desks. Maybe they can ask vendors to put them out for them. We've actually gotten different businesses to put our brochures out. Other smaller governmental entities will work with us because we're the county. So I have numerous townships and municipalities that will cover, you know, the little section and put our brochures out for people. So that's a great way to get your word out through brochures. Handing brochures out to the people who come to your event on something else. So maybe they came to drop off household hazardous waste, or you're telling them about electronics, you know, or you're telling them about a book reuse or some other thing. So always handing things out that way. Whenever you design a brochure, it's really important that you keep some white space on it. Okay? I am terrible at this. That is the bane of my existence. I have all this information and I want to get it out there. And so I just want to squeeze it into the small spot, no margins. Right? And who wants to read that? So keep in mind your audience. Okay, people like bullet points. They really do. They like to think that they're going to breeze through something quickly. Having more white space gives the illusion that this is only going to take you a second to read it. Right? Also, the other thing is as people age, they don't like looking at small fonts. So 11 is the smallest that I go on a printed piece of paper. But if I can bump it up higher than that, I will. Always something to keep in mind. So as tempting as it may be to go down to size 8, don't do it. And then the actual font type. And I will tell you this is a pet peeve of mine. When you're reading something in a paragraph form especially, but bullet points will work as well, when you're actually trying to read words, having a font like Times New Roman, and I know a lot of people are very bored with Times New Roman, it's been around forever. Okay. I personally can tell you I'm bored with it too, but it's nice, dense, it does what I want it to do. It has a little extra ink at the end of each letter, like a little circle. You look really closely at it. What that does is when you're reading a word, you will unconsciously have your eye keep going. Your eye wants to just keep moving along it. However, if you're reading numbers, Arial is a much better font. Because Arial is going to actually cut off none of those little doohickeys at the end of their letters. So that means those numbers are going to be very clear to you, which is what you need numbers to be. A lot lot of times, if you've ever noticed, when you're in Excel, that's the default font in many Excel programs is Arial. There's a reason for that. Okay? And it's just something I throw out to you just to kind of be aware of when you're designing things. And if you're writing a big report and you choose Arial, unconsciously, it's actually more difficult to read it. It's going to be harder for people's eyes. They just get more tired seeing each letter separately. Okay? Even though obviously they're in order, but that's just the way your mind works. So it's just something to keep in mind. For residents, customers, ways to get other communication out, I love postcards. Because even if you discarded the postcard, and then if you kept it out of the mailbox, you had to look at it. You actually had to look at it. Now, I've been told that letters are way more effective from a governmental agency. Okay? From a business, not necessarily. People get inundated. Okay? There's just more junk mail. But from a governmental agency, oh, you got to open it if it says Will County or the state of Illinois or, you know, the city of. Okay? You have to open that. That's official. Maybe. Okay? But I still like the postcards. I just tend to think people have to read it before they throw it away. I like brightly colored. The black and white, cheaper thing to do, I try to avoid it. Colors get people's attention. Yellow gets people's attention. Okay? So keep those things in mind when you're trying to design things. You want their attention. Newsletters, we talked a little bit about newsletters, but besides the municipal newsletters or county or whatever it is, there's also subdivision newsletters. And this is only in certain areas, it's not across the board. But there are subdivisions that seem to have their own little miniature identity, you know, separate from the city that they're in, separate from the rest of their location. You know, they'll come to your drop-off site and say, oh, where are you from? And they'll give you the name of their subdivision. I used to work in the city of Naperville, very true there. Every subdivision, they know. And they know that their house price averaged this in their subdivision, and that subdivision over there, their house price. You know what? You're going to get plowed the same as that one. I don't care. Snow falls, we don't care. Same garbage service. But so it's something to keep in mind because that is a great resource for you. If you can't reach somebody through the newspaper because now you don't really have that many newspapers, or going back to my Naperville example, I have people there who read the Wall Street Journal. I'm not putting anything in the Wall Street Journal. Okay. So that might be their daily newspaper. They're not going to see a word from me. So making sure but they'll read their subdivision newsletter. They want to know what's going on in the subdivision. Okay? So that's a great resource for you. And they talk. So the president of the subdivision or the person in charge of the newsletter, they're out at the playground talking to the other parents while their kids are swinging on the swings. Great time to have them talk about what you need to talk about. Okay? Newspaper advertising, just because it's going away, don't rule it out. I got lots of folks who still use their newspaper. We do surveys every time we do a drop-off event, and we still get a good return on our newspaper advertising. It's not as great as it used to be, but we still get a very good return. There's no reason to rule that out. Yes, it is a little pricier. Okay? And look at different places to put your ad. You know, especially, you know, I've seen ads that were really eye-catching in the health